Hey everyone, Avis here. I'm just recording this quick vlog as I've just seen Prometheus and I wanted to share my thoughts on the film. Before we get into that though, there are a couple of other films I've seen lately that I'd just like to touch on, so spend a couple of minutes on these. The first is Men in Black 3. Men in Black 3, actually, honestly, a really good movie. Not like one of the all-time classics, but entertaining. It's not as good as the first one, but it is still a vast improvement on the second one. Anyone who's seen the second one will know that that was a train wreck. That was a really, really bad movie. This one, if it has any weakness, it's the fact that they're parroting the first one too much. And it's like they do shot for shot, scene for scene sort of bits where they just remake bits of the original. Like some of it is so subtle that you barely notice it, like a shot of Will Smith standing on top of a car aiming gun at retreating enemy, shot of Will Smith lying on pavement dazed, enemy attack forces him to recover and he rolls to the side. There was one of him jumping out the window, exposition at a baseball stadium. There were quite a few of these, and if you watch, it's difficult to pick them out specifically because they're just these tiny little moments, but after a while you notice them and it starts to get a little bit irritating. But aside, basically, the creators, they had what it took to make a really good movie, and I think they were just too worried about sticking to the formula that they knew worked. I think that they were skilled enough to warrant taking the risk, and if they had taken that risk and moved away from the first one a little bit more, we probably would have been delivered a much better film. But as it stands, the film is pretty good. Josh Brolin as K is fucking incredible. He must have been following Tommy Lee Jones around or something, because he gets the walk, he gets the speech patterns, the mannerisms, even the stance. He gets everything about this character. That performance is like a joy to behold. Will Smith is also really good in it, but hey, Will Smith is awesome. I'm a big Will Smith fan. So you might have to take that one with a pinch of salt. Strangely enough, I felt the weakest performance was actually Tommy Lee Jones. He seems really tired. And I don't know if that's something that they're doing with the character, like the character's getting old and cranky and, you know, he's had enough of this shit. But he just, like, every time he's on screen, he's just like, oh God, here I go again. Oh, fuck. Oh, God, I don't want to be here. And that's quite disconcerting, especially when you consider the sort of performances that he's put out in the past. Again, it may well have been intentional, but it was a little distracting. He's not in the movie for most of it anyway, so it doesn't really matter. Josh Brolin takes the role. There's no Frank the Pug. He is alluded to in the background of one scene. I say the background, but it's like the focus of the whole frame is this big billboard advertising this amazing talking pug that comes with this travelling carnival or something. The only purpose of that scene is to have that billboard in it. Rip Torn is missing as well. I don't know why he didn't take on the role of Zed again, but honestly, he and Frank the Pug were my two favourite things about the Men in Black movie. So I was a bit sad to see that Rip Torn wasn't there. But again, it was a really good movie in spite of these criticisms. I enjoyed it. I'll probably get it when it comes out on DVD, and it's a great family flick. I think the difference it's gone from Men in Black 2 is Men in Black 1, if you're making a good family flick, which is what Men in Black 1 was supposed to be, you have to take it seriously. Now, you can make it off the cuff, light-hearted and tongue-in-cheek, but you still have to have the serious core for everything to work off. You need to make sure that you've got your characters right, the story makes sense, and that everything fits together neatly. That is the essence, for me at least, of a good movie. The narrative and structure and the basics have to be in place. You can then worry about the rest of it later, and we'll come back to that when I talk about Prometheus, because that's a big part of it. Also, Boris the Animal, the main villain in this, is a far more credible villain than, what was her name in the second one? Selena? Serena? something like that. I don't know. it shows the impact, basically. Oh, yeah, another one. Another echoed scene. A villain picks up object that he thinks is the big thing everyone's after, and it's a fake out. And, of course, there's a plot element there. Everyone after this specific object, which the whole thing turns around. There is so much echoing of scenes. It grates on you after a while. But, like I say, still a good movie. Other thing I've seen recently, Iron Sky. And dear God, that was probably the most entertaining movie I've seen in years. It is now up there with my all-time favourite movies. Now, it's farce. Okay, I'm going to tell you right now. When I said earlier you have to take things serious and you have to have that serious core, the exception to that is farce, but you still need to take the production of the film seriously. Okay, you can have a ludicrous setup, ludicrous characters, ludicrous story, ludicrous premise, but that doesn't mean that you can neglect your tradecraft. And that's something Iron Sky does very well. Because let's face it, Nazis escaping to the moon in 1940, Nazis escaping to the moon in 1945, and then coming back to invade 60, 70 years later. That is stupid, alright? You can't take that seriously, alright? It's like trying to take Mecha Hitler seriously. So they don't try. They just make it a flat-out comedy, and they just accept the whole setup is stupid, and they just roll with it, and the entire film is just idiotic setup after idiotic setup after idiotic setup. But they take it seriously, they frame their shots nicely, the visuals are well done, the actors put in their lines very well, and the end result is a very well put together farce. I loved it again. It's echoing scenes from other films, and because they're drawing stuff from other films, the echoing didn't bother me, because it's references, it's satire. They take the piss out of the downfall internet meme. They parrot that scene pretty much shot for shot, and it's a wonder to behold. Another one I picked up on was the Doctor Strangelove reference. Doctor Strangelove is one of my all-time favourite movies. If you've not seen it, go and see it. Well, you won't be able to go and see it because it's not really in the cinemas anymore, but you can pick it up on DVD and it's well worth a watch. So we have that set up, and the plot is... I can't even really tell you the plot, because the plot is the Nazis come back, and it's just stupid and funny, and it is in many regards kind of what Men in Black 1 was like. Okay, if you want the plot, then the American president, who is totally not Sarah Palin at all, decides to try and win her next term of election by sending a black guy to the moon. The campaign is called Black to the Moon. This does touch on one thing, actually. I wouldn't say this film is racist, because that's a very charged word to use. I think it's... the black character they have in it and the way that they approach the race, it's very much a sort of grindhouse exploitation attitude. It's not offensively so. They never, I think, cross the lines of propriety. You know what I mean. I'm stumbling over my words. They never cross the line. But at the same time, they're edging quite close to it. But anyway, one of the astronauts is killed, and the black guy, who is a model with no experience, is dragged off back to the Nazi base on the moon. They pick up his smartphone, and while they've got plenty of like space travel technology and things, their computing technology is never advanced. So this smartphone is like thousands of times more powerful than any computer there. They're still running on things with valves. And they have this... it's a Death Star, alright? It's got some really weird, like, over-the-top German name, like Gotterdammerung or something like that. But it's the fucking Death Star, alright? Call a spade a spade. So they can use this to finally control the Death Star. Only problem is it runs out of batteries. So one of the German officers decides that he's going to take a ship back to Earth and recover computers. Whilst he's there, though, he's taken to the President of the United States and agrees to rerun her election campaign for her in true Nuremberg rally style. It's so over the top and so stupid in the setup, so you can't help but find it awesome. So he does this basically to amass power of his own so that he can go back to the moon and become the space Führer. Unfortunately, the real Führer finds out and comes down to kill him. He ends up killing the Führer, assumes the mantle of Führer, and begins the invasion. And then there's the climactic fight sequence, and it's discovered that all the countries of the world have been arming their stuff. And there's a great bit where a North Korean representative is claiming that it's all the North Koreans doing because no one else will own up to it. He says, "Oh, the glorious leader put these ships in place," and then everyone just starts laughing at him. The whole film, it did echo Dr. Strangelove quite heavily in terms of the sub-themes and the ideas of it. I'm not trying to imply this movie is in any way intelligent. It certainly has parallels, and it's satirizing certain elements, so that there's scope for analysis here. It isn't a no-brainer, not by any stretch of the imagination, but the focus of the film is just on pure entertainment value. It is made for the lowest common denominator, with a side for the people who like to really get into their movies and analyze them. So, big recommendation on Iron Sky. Hilarious film. Absolutely hilarious. Okay, so let's get to the meat and potatoes of this one. Prometheus. Now, I'm just going to bring up my notes, because when I got out of the theatre is basically an hour and a half walk from here. So I've walked an hour and a half to get there, and I walked an hour and a half back. And I started making notes on my smartphone, dictating them. And by the time I got back, I still hadn't finished, and I had to spend another 15-20 minutes dictating more notes, which I then had to type up. There's a lot to talk about here. So, broad strokes, is it good? No. And I'm not going to do a sting and say, it's awesome! It's not good. I've seen worse movies, and I'm sure many people will have seen a lot worse. It's not a terrible movie, it's not an atrocious movie, it's not up there with The Asylum, or down there with The Asylum, depending on how you put it, but it is very much subpar. It really does fail to hit the mark on some very basic points, and I think a lot of it is Ridley Scott sacrificing character, narrative, and so on, in favour of symbolism and trying to be highbrow. And we'll get it more into that later, but this is just my opinion, but I think that the very core of a film is you have to make sure the narrative makes sense, the plot holes are closed, the characters behave in a reasonable fashion for who they are. You can have characters acting like idiots, you can have them making stupid mistakes, but only if it's suitable for the character to do it and it's the sort of mistake they make. And that's something where Prometheus really does fall flat on its face. Now, I've read a few articles interpreting the symbolism and so on, and there does seem to be some very good ideas there, and Scott does seem to have managed to get in another layer of understanding onto the movie, but it's like building a house on a foundation of sand. At the end of the day, the experience that you get is very poor. It's no good having all this wonderful symbolism if you've got to suffer through a terrible plot and such poor characters to actually get to it. Now, there's a big lack of internal consistency. Even within the movie itself, it contradicts things that it sets up. That it makes no sense, and that to me is schoolboy error. That is something any editor should be able to pick up on. You know, I've written stuff, I've not done it professionally, but I've done my writing, I've had people edit it, and even just a friend reading over your work, even if they're not a professional editor, will spot internal inconsistencies within your work, and there are some pretty big ones in Prometheus. So that's something that really wound me up. Like I said, I don't think there was much of a substance to it. There was a lot of symbolism, but there was no substance. When you take the scope of the film, basically, is it's Star Trek V. We're going out to find our creators. Not necessarily God, but the people who seeded human life on planet Earth. Wow. All right, that is a setup. That is the scope for one hell of a movie. We're going to meet the people who made us and ask why. How do you even begin to encompass that? How do you even begin to explore that concept? And as we'll see, they don't. They never... Okay, I don't say they never. There are a few scenes where they allude to this, and a few scenes where they just kind of... But they reference the idea. They reference it without ever actually exploring it. And again, I think that in terms of the levels that you would build a movie on, well, that I would build a movie on, again, this is my opinion, the first level, the foundation, the most important level, plot, characters. Second level, meaning, exploration of themes. Top level, symbolism and deep, and that analytical interpretation. If you can do well on all three of those, you've got a fantastic movie on your hands. Doctor Strangelove is one reason why I like that. And even Ridley Scott's own film Blade Runner has all those. You've got Decker, a character with a clear motive, clear purpose, works in an intelligent and reasoned fashion towards his goals, and basically we like him, we want him to succeed. Second level, exploration of themes. What does it mean? Where is life? Do we have this responsibility of creating life? Where do we draw the line between these replicants and these humans? When does the artificial creation of something, if it's close enough, become the thing that it's interpreting? Great, and that's explored as well. And then finally, the symbolism. Rutger Hauer's speech at the end. It doesn't get much more symbolic than that scene. So you've got all those in place. And the problem with Prometheus is it's missing the first two and it's just skipped straight to symbolism. It has very little to do with the Alien franchise. Very little at all. The aliens in it are like proto-aliens, so they're not they don't really have much of a bearing on the aliens we know and love. But that's okay, you know, it's disappointing in many regards, because I can't help but feel that Ridley Scott had a different film planned and billed this as a prequel to Alien because of basically franchise magnetism. And to be honest, given the culture in cinema at the moment where everything is sequels, remakes, and so on, that's like almost everything that we're getting these days. I think it's very easy to believe that this started out as a completely unrelated script. Because really, if you took out the reference to Weyland-Yutani, there wouldn't be any connection to the Alien franchise. Oh, apart from the place it takes place, starting with the name LV and then three numbers. Apart from that, no connection to the Alien franchise whatsoever. That felt like a bait and switch. I mean, I was promised Alien, and what I got was sort of weirdish pseudo-Alien. Now, granted, it's like aliens took liberties with the ideas of the alien life cycle from Alien, but it felt more like it expanded on it, if you know what I mean. Like, the idea of the aliens dragging them back to the Hive, it's like, well, that makes sense. That's how hived creatures behave. And remember, in Alien, there was one alien. In Aliens, you've now got a hive of the things, so their behaviour in a group is probably going to be different. But this felt like it was just taking way too many liberties. And again, the idea is this was like proto-alien, this is what the aliens came from, but it doesn't change the fact that the alien connection has been shoehorned in there. But you may not find that a problem. I did, but you may not. If you're willing to accept it, then meh, that's fine. Big problem, this was a total idiot plot. A complete, absolute, total idiot plot. And by those who are not familiar with the term, idiot plot means a story that only carries on because the characters involved behave like complete idiots. If they added an ounce of actual effort or thought into what they were doing, the story would be solved, the mystery would be revealed, and everything would be over. In this case, it's idiot plot because, in typical Hollywood tropes, scientists, these highly trained professionals, probably the cream of the crop, picked for this trillion-dollar expedition to meet our creators. First contact with an alien race that also created us. These people are idiots. We'll get into the specifics later down the line because I want to draw a line in this review of spoilers start here. So the spoilers don't start here. The spoilers don't start here. Stay away from the stop button. But I want to draw a line in the sand for people who haven't seen the film yet. But basically, just think of all the ways that scientists have behaved in Hollywood movies that are completely inconsistent with their training. They show a complete inability to process hazardous materials safely. No quarantine procedures, no decontamination procedures. It's like a junior school chemistry lab. It's complete and utter chaos. And the annoying thing is there is one character who is working against the others from the inside, and that alone would be enough that there would be contamination and danger and there would be a plot. The characters didn't need to act like idiots. Unfortunately, for some bizarre reason, they do, and it's very difficult for me to feel any empathy or connection to a character when their first instinct on seeing a strange gooey thing on an alien planet is to stick their finger in it. Finally, this is something which I think is just me putting my own beliefs and values on the line and having it influence the film. So this is something that people may take away from... This is something that people may not get from the film at all. I think this is just my personal interpretation of this. But I was actually somewhat insulted by it at times. I'm an atheist. I'm quite an ardent atheist. I'm not militant about it, but There is no faith in my heart. I have zero belief in the idea of God. I respect that other people do, and I respect that the idea of where we came from is a huge philosophical question to many people, and it's something that many people would like a definitive answer to. And as such, a film based around these themes, I can appreciate it. I can look at the argument. I can understand it. I can be entertained by it. I can get some intellectual stimulation from it. Even if it's not an issue to me, I can still derive that enjoyment. So I would like you to understand where I'm coming from when I say a lot of this felt like religious propaganda. Now, obviously I need to quantify that statement, and it's quite difficult to do it because it was like a feeling. It was a taste in the back of my mouth after the film. But I think the problem is there's a lot of references to faith, and there's a lot of references to religion, and there's a lot of references to belief. And it's never really expanded on. And when these ideas are threatened, like they do ask one of the religious characters, well, how does the existence of aliens, especially if they created us, tie into your religious views? You know, you're a Christian, you believe that God created us. How does that tie in if these guys created it, and you're the one telling us they did? And she's responding, well, who created them? Right, okay, fine. Personally, I think that would be worth looking into a little bit more, but okay, fair dues. But then it's things like, well, why did you come all the way out here if you don't have any belief? Well, scientific curiosity. You know, you can't infer that there's faith or belief in wanting to know where we came from. If these people, we'll get to this in the spoiler section, but if these people genuinely believe that these creatures created humanity, the sheer scientific curiosity is plenty to get people out there. And there's a fact that the religious character is the only one who survives the movie. Ah, shit, that was spoilers. All right, I'm going to stick like a warning in before I put that out. So basically, this religious character, it all starts out in this film from this side, from that seed, and as I say, it's very difficult to quantify because there were just lots of little scenes where they were going faith, faith, belief, faith, belief, and never going anywhere with it. And there was also the complete, they completely ignored the idea of science in this film. Someone says, the response, like, oh, we're going to meet our creators, huh? So I guess, like, we're just throwing 300 years of Darwinism out the window. And the character's response is, yes, they engineered us because that's what I choose to believe. And this is one of the scientists speaking. It's not like we have very strong evidence that this is the case. I don't know how we reconcile this with our current theories of evolution, but maybe they can tell us. Fix that line of dialogue for you right there. Because it is never answered. In fact, the whole idea of genetics and evolution is really screwed in this movie. And again, once we get into the spoiler section, I'll detail exactly why. But suffice to say, it's to anyone who has even a modicum of understanding of genetics, like we're talking the genetics they teach you in school. You know, you don't need to be a biology major to get this. This is like the shit they teach you in biology classes in school, and they get it wrong. Really, really, fundamentally wrong. So, idiot plot, bad setup with the science, nothing to do with the Alien franchise, shoddy writing, inconsistent even within its own universe, and an emphasis, I think, on symbolism over exploration of ideas and actual solid narrative. At the end of the day, I just think it's a bad film. It does, however, look pretty. Apart from one scene, which is like an action sequence, which is horribly shot, absolutely horrible. It is, in terms of the ability to see what's actually going on, it's worse than the fight scenes in Alien vs. Predator Requiem. And anyone who's seen that movie will know that it's like watching it through a sheet of silk. You know, it's so dark you can't see shit. And this scene is worse than that. It's completely incomprehensible. But aside from that, the rest of it is actually really well shot. It looks pretty. You got big sweeping vistas, and there's a lot of detail on the machinery. And when they're inside the alien ship, it's got like this the whole Geiger-esque thing going on. And it's visually speaking, it's great. But the rest of it just falls flat on its face. So anyway. If you're worried about spoilers, stop this now, because I'm going to be transitioning into spoiler territory, where I'm going to basically go through the film and pick apart the scenes and basically explain specifically what's wrong with it. There are some good bits in the film, but honestly, the good bits, as I say, are the cinematography. They are the way that the film looks. So this from now out, this is basically criticism. So, if you don't want criticism, if you want like conjecture and analysis, then you're gonna have to find a different review, because honestly, I don't have much positive to say about this film. Anyway, here are the spoilers. So, my first big problem with this film is actually the opening credits. It starts off with it's a minute and a half, 2 minutes of just shots of rolling vistas, and okay, it's beautiful landscape and it's beautiful cinematography, but it doesn't start up anything with the story, it doesn't let us know what's going on, and it's literally just eye candy, eye candy, eye candy. And you know, it's two, three minutes of the film that you could have used to set something up, that you could have used to establish ideas and things. Instead, it's just, look at the beautiful rolling valleys of Scotland. And then you've got one of this, you've got the the aliens in this are called the Engineers. They're the aliens that supposedly created life on Earth, or at least humans. Not the alien xenomorph aliens, but different aliens altogether called, I say, Engineers. So Engineers, these guys. And an Engineer looks like this. It's a human, but it's built like a roid monkey. It's about 8 feet tall, completely bald, absolutely albino. And when I say it's about 8 feet tall, I don't mean it's like an 8 foot tall human. I mean it's built as a human that's had its proportions geared up. So everything is larger. Like Titans, like Prometheus. Ooh, symbolism. So one of these things is standing like at the top of a waterfall as the ship leaves. And it drinks from this cup, and this thing is poison. And this stuff is like a black goo, and we'll get to the black goo later, and this is another thing that I found quite annoying about this film, was it takes... I couldn't stop drawing parallels between this movie and the X-Files movie, the one with the black oil in it and the bees. Yeah, they have a lot in common. But anyway, he drinks this thing, and like his body starts like completely fall apart, and he falls into the water. We get like super microscopic close up of his DNA falling apart, and then as it falls into the water, it like springs back to life and starts to recombine. So it's like, okay, so we've got seeding going on. Why do you need to kill a guy to do it? I mean, if you're going to seed the planet, couldn't you like give this stuff to like a dog, or you know, maybe a high order primate? You know, I'm not condoning animal testing here, but it seems to me like, you know, killing someone to do this is, like, possibly more trouble than it's worth. But either way, you know, that's nitpicking. That's just a tiny little gripe, so we're not going to spend any time on it. But anyway, after the credits roll, we see David, who is one of the central characters of the film. He's the android. And he's basically amusing himself on the ship by watching his crew members' dreams. And we see the basis of another character, Elizabeth Shaw, her basis, her foundation in religion. It's a dream in which she's in India with her father. Some funeral procession goes by and her father has to explain death to her and the concept of afterlife. David then people then start waking up after the ship arrives at the point, which has taken about 2 years, I think, 2 or 3 years. So the ship's arrived, and people are waking up, and now they get the mission briefing. So they didn't get the mission briefing while they were on Earth. They didn't get the mission briefing as part of the selection for the people on the team. They're getting it now. And this makes all sorts of... this makes all sorts of no sense. I can appreciate the Wayland Corporation might want to keep this whole thing like a big secret, but this is some pretty major league shit here, alright? We're talking about going out and meeting, for want of a better term, our gods, our creators, as well as first contact with alien life. That's like two huge deals. And how do they know that these people are going to hold up to that? And of course, they don't. Later on in the film, when it becomes apparent what's going on, two of the guys completely freak out. So one would think that maybe if they'd advertised this a little bit better, like you could get people in and then like make them sign a secrecy document or something, or if you really wanted to keep it shtum, pay them like you know, several grand a year to keep their mouths shut. And, you know, It just boggles my mind that these people have just come out here and they had no idea why they were coming out here. And that's something that's, again, lacks the internal consistency. Remember that. They came out here completely blind. Only two people in this entire film, Shaw and her partner, whose name I couldn't remember, Alien Chow, are the only two people who actually know why they're there. I think Charlize Theron's character, Meredith Vickers, does as well. I think it's never explicitly stated that she knew, but it's inferred. But most of the crew, so like three people out of a crew, I think it was 17, know why they're there. The rest of them don't have a clue. Many of them respond with complete incredulity at the idea. But, of course, they're there anyway. But to most of them, they're just there for a paycheck. Okay. I think the next one is the chain of command. The ship has no defined chain of command. So you've got Meredith Vickers, who... Oh, no, we'll start out with the two doctors, Shaw and her partner. Now, in Weyland's holographic briefing, he basically says, these two motherfuckers are in charge. Literally says, right, these guys are in charge of the mission. No questions there. Okay, fine, fantastic. We know who we're following. Meredith Vickers then calls them to her private chambre and basically says, yeah, if you find anything, you do fuck all. You come back to me and you tell me first. This isn't your mission. So you're just employees. The Weyland Corporation put $1 trillion into this project. So, you know, we're calling the shots. And out here, I am the company. The dwarf fans got a giggle out of that. The rest of you are just going, huh? Anyway, so we've now got three people in charge of this project. And there is now a fourth person, and a guy who's basically referred to as Captain, and is this big black guy, and curiously, in an Alien movie, he survives almost to the very end. But he's called Captain, and at first I just thought, right, okay, that's just like a rank, like, okay, he's a pilot in the Air Force or something, or the Space Corps or whatever, and he's here to just fly the ship and, you know, make sure that the ship is running. So he has no, like, actual authority over the mission. But later on, he starts giving orders, and he's countermanding Meredith Vickers' orders. And he's not doing it in such a way as it's like, don't listen to her, you know you've got to do this. He sounds like he's pulling rank. He's saying, I am the captain, do this. So you have no clear chain of command on this $1 trillion space exploration project. I'd call that a nitpick, but, you know, we're less than, I think, 10-15 minutes into the film at this point, and you've already got these little inconsistencies. And the thing is, I can let these things go. If there's only a couple of these things in a movie, I can just let it go, because, you know, a screenwriter can't explain every last little detail. If you want to nitpick a movie, you will always find stuff to nitpick. The key is how much of a nitpick something is, and in this case, it's a fairly big flaw there, and how many there are. Because a film may not have, like, any one major thing wrong with it, but if every 5 minutes you're going, huh? What? Eh? You know, that detracts from the experience. Okay, so I mentioned Vickers' private chambre. And this is important for later, because again, it's a complete fuck-up of the internal consistency of the film. And this thing is built like a five-star hotel's lounge. It's got, like, beautiful columns and a bar, and there's a fucking grand piano, and this holographic window that shows wonderful different vistas. And this, like, automatic surgery device. And she explains that, okay, the whole, like, grandiose opulence of it, I can buy, alright? If she's the fucking captain, if she's leading the expedition, if she's the company person, it makes sense that she's going to have this wonderful place to sleep. But she explains that it's like a self-contained lifeboat. So it's got, like, air and food and water for 2 years, and it's got this automatic surgery thing in case she needs any medical attention. And we'll come back to the surgery thing later, because that's the shit kicker in this. So they've arrived at the planet, they've had their briefing, they go down into the atmosphere, and lo and behold, like, within 20-30 minutes or whatever, there's no specific amount of time given, but it's inferred that it's just after re-entry. They visually, without any sorts of, like, scanners or sensor sweeps or whatever, again, those are the sorts of things that you wouldn't expect in an Alien movie, so, you know, I'm not saying they shouldn't be there, But visual confirmation, they spot where they need to go. They spot this mound with like a wall around it that couldn't possibly be natural. It's like, wow, that's a fucking stroke of luck, isn't it? You know, you've gone down into the planet, and within moments, you've found out where you need to go. And it's not like later on they actually establish this is not their homeworld. This is just an outpost, which seems to infer quite heavily that there's only a small area on this planet where they're actually operating. And they found it without trying when they entered the atmosphere. And again, maybe I missed something. Maybe they had like some sort of indicator as to where it would be on the surface, but I don't think that was made particularly clear. But again, it's a nitpick, but it's yet another nitpick within the space of a couple of minutes of the last one, and it's a fairly large thing. And you know, this isn't me sitting down and watching the movie over and over again on DVD. This is after just one viewing. Normally, to get like a lot of nitpicks together in a row, you need to watch a film a couple of times, but you didn't hear. So they find it instantly, and they refer to it as a pyramid, even though it's more like a mound. It is not like even remotely pyramid shaped. It's just like it's like a barrow. Anyway, so they land the ship nearby, and they get into all their like expeditionary gear. So they've got these suits. It looks like everything from the neck down is like the Mass Effect armor, and then they've got these like huge bulbous plastic helmets that go over it. Initially, it looks kind of stupid, like 1960s sci-fi thing, but it makes a lot of sense. It gives them full like 360 degree vision. So you know, I like the design. I actually do like the design. It looks like environmental suits. So they check the atmosphere. And they find that whilst it's got, in theory, it's breathable, but the problem is it's got like 3% carbon dioxide. So, you know, you breathe it for more than a few minutes and you'll choke to death. I can't remember off the top of my head, but I'm pretty sure it's carbon monoxide that replaces oxygen in hemoglobin in the blood. I don't think carbon dioxide does that, but you know, that might be well and truly wrong. That's like on the cusp of my memory somewhere. So take that with a pinch of salt and double check it if you're going to use it in any sort of sense. So they go into the mound, and they discover that the air inside is breathable. As like the humidity's changed, so the carbon dioxide level has dropped, and it's now perfectly breathable. So, naturally, one of them just goes, "Hey, I'm going to take my helmet off." Yeah, you're immediately going, okay, breathable doesn't mean safe. Yeah, technically, the air in a virology lab is safe. Well, technically it's breathable. That doesn't mean it's safe. So Shaw is going to this guy, "Don't take your fucking helmet off. Don't take your fucking helmet off. Don't take it off." And he just goes, "Oh, don't be a skeptic." Again, that harkens back to the whole thing I was saying earlier about it seems to be like sort of pro-religious propaganda sort of thing. It's like, "Oh, you're a skeptic." Well, no, she's fucking right. And anyway, he pops the helmet off, and because he doesn't like immediately die of explosive Martian diarrhea, everyone else goes, "Hey!" Takes the helmets off. So yeah, there could be anything in the air. God knows what sort of alien microbes, and they're just going like, "Hey!" So you see, now this is where it establishes the arc for these characters. Well, not the arc, it establishes the problem for these characters. They are stupid. Colossally, apocalyptically stupid. They have no concept of self-preservation, no concept of how to operate in a dangerous environment. No concept of how to handle dangerous materials. And this is just the start. It gets worse. It gets worse on that score, really. So the android David, while he's wandering around behind them, I think this comes before they take the helmet off, but it doesn't really matter. He finds this like control panel on the wall, and it's oozing this goo. So what's the first thing he does? Ooh. Ooh. It's like, you know, the stuff might be highly corrosive and could eat into your suit and force your access to the air that you don't know is breathable yet. He doesn't actually need to breathe, but at the same time, if it can eat through the suit, maybe it'll eat through his skin. Even if it's not corrosive, it could be some sort of fungal spore that could be hell to get off. And as we'll see later, they don't have any decontamination procedures. None. So he could be carrying something hideously infectious back onto the ship by sticking his finger in this stuff. So, straight away the stupidity starts. So then he starts messing with the control panel. Now, it's established in, the first few minutes of the film that he's been learning the root of different languages and try to combine them. So in theory, assuming that all languages were rooted in one common ancestor, this common ancestor may well have been these engineers. Makes sense. So in theory, maybe he's got some sort of cultural recognition as well, so he can understand the control panels. So he's messing about with this control panel, and he triggers some sort of holographic playback system, which shows these engineers fleeing from something, and they're all running away, and we don't know what they're running away from, and everyone's like, ah, what the fuck, 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 ah, what the fuck. So anyway, as that chaos ensues, they're running, and eventually they realize, okay, yeah, these things are harmless, and they come to a door where the body of one of these things is laid out in front of the door. And they go oh, wow, oh, crap, this is actually real. And two of the guys just basically freak out. One of them goes, I'm a fucking geologist. I don't do these dead body things. You don't need a geologist here. I do rocks. I'm out. I'm gone. And one other guy decides to go with him. Now, bear in mind, these two leave immediately. So they're not fleeing in terror, total abject panic, It's very much a case of, right, okay, this shit is too much for me, I'm going. Anyone with me? You? Brilliant. Alright, we're out. So they're not fleeing in abject terror, which would indicate that they're probably going back to the ship. And indeed they say, I'm going back to the ship. I'd like you to remember this for later. So anyway, David manages to open the door, and lo and behold, inside there is the guy's head. Now, I don't know if you've read Sandman, but the guy, the engineers wear helmets, and it's Dream's battle helmet. The big thing that looks like a sort of squid-esque thuloid thing. It looks identical. For all intents and purposes, it is identical. I don't know if they have a root common symbolism or something, but either way, it's worth mentioning. So one of the scientists gets busy ziplock bagging the head. Literally, it's a big ziplock bag they're putting the head in. Okay, it makes perfect sense that's where you put it in, but it's still quite funny. But the problem is, in this room there are these vases or vases or whatever, however the hell you want to pronounce it, around this giant head. The giant head, I think, is probably some sort of symbolism that I completely missed. But after a while, they're wandering around this room, and these vases start to, sweat. And, basically, don't touch it, don't fucking touch it, don't touch it. And when she sees David trying to poke it, and when her back's turned, David immediately is like, fascinating. So, Shaw sees that they're all starting to melt or sweat or whatever, and basically reasons that they've changed the atmospheric composition of the room and they've triggered something, and it might be a good idea to get out. So, alright, props. Smart move. So she says, right, we're out, we're out, we're out, we're out, let's get out of here. We don't know what's going on, it's not safe, we're out. So she's out, they take the head with them. They have to shout at David several times. He surreptitiously slips one of the big vases, oozing the black oil from X-Files, into a rucksack. So they run, and they're told that a big storm is coming. And this is Red Planet dust storm shit. It's really dangerous winds, and pieces of silica in it that will rip you apart. So it's you do not want to be caught outside in this shit. So they all head back. Only problem, the two guys who left to get back before them have been left behind and are lost. To make matters worse, one of these guys was mapping the place. He's got these little, like, balls he calls pups, and he chucks it into the air, and it starts doing, like, a LADAR scan of the cavern, and then it moves off. And you see, when they cut back to the ship, they've got this big holographic table, and there's, like, a 3D map of the base slowly being built up as these things go around and explore. They have a map. They have perfect communications with the ship at every time, at every point. They have perfect communications with each other at every time and every point. The entire party are all intercommunicated, and the ship's intercommunicated. Everyone can communicate with everyone. And I believe that they've got, like, these wrist computers as well, so these guys should be able to, like, pull up the maps. And even if they can't pull up the maps, they should be able to remember the way that they've come. And even if they can't remember the way they've come, they can say, right, ship, we're heading back. Can you give us directions, please? Because they've got location markers on the map as well where they are, which are updated in real time. How the fuck did these guys get lost? Okay, this is the first, like, really big inconsistency in the film. And it's kind of important because, spoiler alert, they die. So, these two chuckle fucks are, like, completely lost. Even though they should, if anything, have been waiting for the rest of the party to get back to the vehicles. So, they're stuck behind in the building. And, whilst they're exploring and they find, like, this heap of dead bodies, heap of dead engineer bodies, like, oh, fuck, man, that's, like, charnel house shit. This is, I think one of them does make a reference to the Holocaust. And then the captain, as in the captain, the guy whose rank is captain, calls him and says, dude, one of your little pups just found a life sign down there. So these guys are standing next to a pile of bodies, and the captain just goes, a life sign down there, Dave. So they, like, look at each other and go, and they're like, fuck, 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 fuck. And then the life sign vanishes. And the captain just goes, oh yeah, false alarm. Bye-bye, guys. And that's it. He leaves them scared shitless. He's basically saying, right, we can't pick you up because of the storm. So he leaves them scared shitless in an alien environment, having just told them that they're not alone. Naturally, these guys don't respond well, and they start they flee, basically. The storm leads to that really badly shot action sequence I said earlier. They're all on these, like, buggies and ATVs and things heading back in, and just before they arrive back at the ship, the storm is, like, right on their asses. It's, like, meters away. Shaw drops the head, so she leaps from a moving vehicle, hits the ground, rolls, grabs the head, and then the storm hits. And after that, I honestly couldn't follow what happened. I think she, like, makes it to shelter in, like, the wind shadow of, like, a landing strut or something. But the way that the cargo bay looks, it looks like you have the bottom of the ship, you've got the landing struts, and then there's an elevator, which is the bottom surface of the ship that comes down and then goes back up again. So there's not, like, any doors or anything. It's just this big lift. Now, I may be wrong there, but that's the way it looked. So then someone else, like, tries to help her, and they're just like, now they're both just trapped in the shadow of the storm with, like, razor sharp bits of silica flying around them. And someone who's later revealed to be David fastens, like, a lifeline onto a door somewhere and goes out and gets them and brings them back. But it's so, like, dusty, murky, and chaotic, you can't actually see it. And okay, you know, that's what it would actually look like in real life, but at the end of the day, we can't see what's going on, and that doesn't make for compelling cinema. Well, maybe it does to you, but in my opinion, if you can't see what's going on in a visual medium, there's been a fuck-up, you know? Even if you don't agree, I'm sure you can understand where I'm coming from. But anyway, they get that rescue, and we go back to the chuckle fucks. These two guys who were stuck in the pyramid. So, they need to bed down for the night. Where do you think they choose to do it? The room where the communications were blasted out. Oh shit, something's going on. We don't know what's happening. Everyone get out of here. The whole reason for leaving is where they've decided to bed down for the night. Not only that, the sweating vases have now sweated so much that actual lakes and pools have started forming on the floor of this stuff. And they thought this was a good place to bed down for the night. Again, complete character idiocy. They're all networked with communications. There is no reason why they shouldn't know this is dangerous. And even if they didn't catch the initial communication, surely the ship, when communicating back with them, should have said, oh, by the way, we pulled out because of this room. You might want to stay away from it because we don't know what's going on. But then again, this is the guy who just said, you got a life sign. Oh, you know, my mistake. Bye. So they settle down. Meanwhile, back on the ship, the captain is hitting on Meredith with the weirdest set of pickup lines I have ever heard. He starts out as something about travelling all the way, she didn't need to travel all the way across the galaxy to get laid, something like that. And then he follows it up as she's leaving with, are you a robot? What? How is that even remotely seductive? You know, okay, yeah, you know, I'm going to admit I'm not Casanova, but you know, I don't see how that line works, but it does. And while they go off to do the horizontal tango, these poor chuckle fucks die because they can't get hold. Well, not because they can't get hold of the ship, but they're gone. There's no contact with them, and the ship doesn't know why. And again, locations. The guy is sitting there. He's got the map. So he's got the map in the room, so he's going to see these guys have wandered into this bit that's supposed to be really dangerous. Why has he not told them to get out? This boggles my mind. And then, of course, more stupidity, he leaves his post completely unmanned just to get laid. Admittedly, by Charlize Theron, who apparently is attractive, I don't really see it myself. But, yeah, again, the stupidity is just piling up. So, anyway, we go back to these two guys in the cavern, and one of them, as if getting lost in the region that you are mapping, that anyone can help you out of, and then bedding down in the most dangerous location possible that is known to be dangerous, is not stupid enough, one of them is getting high. Now, at this point, I'm sure that people are gonna go, oh, yeah, whatever. No, he's getting stoned. We have officially crossed from the realm of just incompetent to utterly, utterly stupid. So, he's getting high in this highly dangerous situation. Now, the thing is, he isn't the stupidest one out of the pair. Now, they spot this, like, ripple moving in the lakes, and then suddenly, this, like, snake pops out. It's like this long body, and it's, like, bulbous thing on its head. And I'm not sure if it's supposed to, like, look, like, vaguely like a penis or something, but it just kind of pops out, and it's like, could look kind of like a sperm, maybe. Maybe that's the symbolism. Either way, it pops out, and it's, like, hovering backwards and forwards like a charmed snake looking at them. So naturally, what's the first thing the biologist, who is incidentally is not the one getting high, that's the geologist, what's the first thing the biologist does? He goes, oh, it's beautiful. Naturally, it doesn't like it. So he's like going, ooh. And then the head, if you will, kind of splits open. And it's like a vaguely face-hugger shaped. So it's like, we're all going, oh, shit. Now, you'd think that something would twig in the idiot's head at this point, because it's like, most animals, they have that sort of response to make themselves look bigger and more threatening when they feel threatened. Pufferfish do it, cobras do it, domestic cats do it, you know, when they screech and they're like, all their fur puffs up, makes them look big. So this, the biologist does not make this connection at all. So he's like, oh, it's pretty. And then the thing starts hissing and spitting at him. So it's gone. Now, at this point, you'd think maybe he'd get the fucking message. No.
It's pretty. Ooh, it's trying to talk to me.
Now, he doesn't actually say that, but it's one step shy. So anyway, naturally, the thing launches an attack on him and wraps itself around his arm. This starts them all freaking out, and basically it's like coiling around him, and it breaks his arm. And he's screaming at the other guy, the geologist, get it off me! So the geologist goes at it with a knife and carves through its tail, pulls its tail off, blood sprays everywhere, and acidic blood! So this guy gets it full across his face mask, which like melts onto him. And he falls face down into the goo, and then he rolls back, and you see the face mask melted away, and the goo is all over his face. And again, X-Files movie moment. And the other guy is like, it's in my suit! And it coils round his head, and then just launches itself down his throat. And the CG effect is terrible. It does not look, like, remotely real at all. Oh yeah, and it regenerates its tail, like, instantly. Which, again, this could be construed as a nitpick, but it's something that really, really bothered me. It's like, this sort of like, it's like, fucking Wolverine didn't regenerate that fast. There's no way you could expend that much energy and that much, you couldn't do that sort of healing in that space of time. I know I'm bringing, like, hard science into this, but, you know, it's... It's not supposed to be a stupid movie. It's not supposed to be like a light-hearted comedy or some shit, or you know, like a superhero flick. That sort of thing just does not happen. So, anyway, we're back in a land where no one knows any basic quarantine or biohazard procedures. They've got the alien head on the desk in front of them on the ship, and they're looking at it, and there's nothing between it and them. It's not in, like, a sealed case or anything like that. And the only thing got for protection is fucking scrubs and a surgical mask. And I don't mean, like, a big, like, face-consuming mask or even, like, a gas mask. No, I mean literally fabric across the mouth and lower nose tied behind the ears. Yeah, dealing with potentially dangerous... Even one of them fucking ran out of the room because they were worried there was going to be dangerous shit in there. And the head they pulled out of that room, they didn't think to quarantine it or, like, keep it behind glass or whatever. Fuck knows. So anyway, they realise that the whole, like, Dreams helmet thing is just a helmet. David lifts it off, and then it's, like, this giant-sized human head, which, from the things we saw earlier, it's an engineer. So then they're looking at this thing, and they find these, like, black spots on it, which is evidently the black oil. And at this point, I don't know if I, like, zoned out from all the stupidity, but they stick a probe into it and say, alright, yeah, stick some electricity into it, we might be able to trick it into thinking that the nervous system, it's still alive. What? So they, like, identify this black stuff as, like, separate thing from it or something? I don't know. But either way, they pump it full of electricity. And eventually the head starts going,
oh god, I'm in a horror movie.
So it starts freaking out, and the black gunk starts like going blah, 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 all over it. And then they say, perhaps we should contain it. Yeah, alright. So they contain it into this like glass box, and then it explodes. That's the scene. And all the while, there's this one guy in the background, and this shows you the quarantine procedures. In the background in his regular clothes, sitting on the bench with a bottle of champagne, just swinging it, watching the whole thing. And then when it explodes, he just gets up and wanders out. Fuck it. Channel 3. So anyway, they pull some of the material, blown up material, from out of the glass box and test it. And here's where the science again really just bends over and takes it up the arse. It comes up with 100% match, DNA 100% match for human. No fucking way. No fucking way. Okay, you can get a lot of variation out of compatible DNA. Like, right, humans look very different from each other, and like, are very different from each other. Dogs as well are a very good example of how you can have genetically compatible, you have DNA which will produce offspring and viable offspring, but which has exceedingly different phenotypes. That's the way that the genes express themselves. Okay, again, this is shit you learn in school. This isn't degree level genetics. This is fucking high school genetics. Okay, you cannot. I honestly don't think that you would be able to get a 100% match with genetic material from people who are 8 feet tall, albino, and hairless, and built like a poster child for steroid abuse. Okay? I just don't see it. And even then, this is 100% compatibility with who? With what? Because there is no, like, you don't have human DNA as such. All genetics exists on a continuum, as it were. Ideas like species are humans inputting boundaries on that continuum. You know, they say like apes are 90-something% human beings. Yeah, well, we share like 70% with certain plants. That gives you an idea of how relevant that material actually is. So, straight off the bat, and how does this work? And it's like, even if you go back to the start of the film, we assume the planet that they were seeding was Earth, and it's like, all our material came from this one guy. It's fucking genetic drift. Again, this is high school level stuff. This is high school science. Genetic drift. Two identical species, isolated for thousands of years, will develop in different ways, often to the point where their DNA can no longer be brought back together to form a viable offspring. So there is no way human DNA is 100% match with these fuckers. It's not possible. I can't make it any clearer than that. It's one of the... It is probably the stupidest moment in the movie from a purely scientific perspective. It's like, even if you accept that you can get this race of giants from, like, human-compatible DNA... If they're separated, and even if you accept that humans are descended from them, like they're our direct genetic ancestors, which again is really pushing it, given centuries of work on evolution. Centuries of work on evolution. The idea's been around. You get my drift. There's a lot of evolutionary evidence that this is complete crock. And even if we suspend that, even if we suspend the and accept that these are our genetic ancestors. The match is not going to be 100%. It's not. They're separated by thousands of fucking years. Oh, God. Okay, I can't even... I'm just going to check my notes here because that was... That's thrown me. Oh, yeah. They referenced Darwin earlier in the film. It's like, oh, so you're going to throw 3 centuries of Darwinism out of the window, are you? She goes, yes, because I believe they made us. Fuck off. Alright, anyway, when they're all on the ship, Fassbender, you know, David's character, is like messing about with this vase with the oily stuff on it, the black oil. And he takes some and he dips it into the Shaw's partner's celebratory champagne. And feeds it to the guy. And it's like the one of the few actual parts of the movie where they are actually addressing this whole idea of being a creator. You've got the robot created by man, talking with man, and he says to the guy, "So, why did you create me?" And he just looks up and says, "Well, we did it because we could." And Fassbender just looks down at the guy and says, "Wouldn't it be very disappointing to find out that your creator answered that question the same way?" I'm paraphrasing, but that's basically it. And it's interactions like that that I think the movie was missing a fair amount of. Some people would say it's ramming it down your throat, but, you know, if you're going to have this, fucking discuss it, you know? Discuss the ramifications of getting the answers to these questions. And that's like the, probably like the only scene, he says something else like, which really fucking bugs me. Like, isn't ultimately, it's like, Shaw is talking to him and like talking about want, how he doesn't want anything because he's a robot and he doesn't have a soul. And he says something, I can't remember the exact context, but it didn't make any sense in context, I don't think. And he says, ultimately, isn't what we all want for our parents to die? Or for us to kill our parents? No. I don't know anyone who wants to kill their parents. I know a few people who really don't get on with their parents, but they don't want to kill them. I think it may be like... I think the idea is alluding to surpassing parents rather than literally killing them, but, you know, never mind. I've lost my train of thought on that anyway. But again, it's like little references to the idea of what it could mean if we were seeded by extraterrestrial life. You know, if we were designed and engineered by another species. It's just... it does raise questions in the viewer, but it doesn't seem like it's trying to. Like, you've got a 2-hour movie and there's like 3 or 4 lines in it maybe that are actually pointing at this. Either way, back on the track. So this guy's been infected with the black oil by Fassbender, David. So he goes to see Shaw, and he's like, "Ah, I have a rose for you for celebration of this." And he gives it to her, and he has a pop at her faith and basically says, "Oh, well, how does this whole alien thing fit in? I mean, guess you can stop wearing the cross now." She goes, no. "Well, how do you reconcile? You know, they made us. It's not God. They did. You think they made us as well. Well, but who made them?" So, you know, again, you're not really giving me anything here. This is a question that I could arrive at on my own. This is a question any idiot could arrive at on their own. If we were made by someone else, who made them? That's not particularly deep. It's not intelligent. It's just... it's desperately grasping at a point and not actually giving us anything interesting to think about it. He then proceeds to go, "Well, it's all meaningless anyway. It's like, anyone can make life. You just need like a pinch of DNA and off you go." This is incredibly stupid for so many reasons. It's like, he has no idea how these things created life. And even as of yet, they have no evidence that these things did create humans. In fact, you know what? I don't think at any point in the film it's actually determined that these things did create people. It's like, at the start of the film, there's like lots of different cultures that never met each other, but all have this same cave painting, or, you know, painting of whatever, you know, and then worshipping these big beings and a star cluster pattern, which is like the map of where they found the planet, which, you know, raises all sorts of fucking questions, but I'm not gonna dwell on that one. But there's nothing to say that these guys just didn't come down and go, worship us, right, we've got everything that we needed or whatever from you now, right, we're fucking off. I actually don't think, the DNA 100% match thing. Yeah, okay, yeah. But ignore me, I've got, like, zero functional memory at the moment. This brain killed my intelligence. This movie killed my brain intelligence. You see the evidence. You see it? I am in cognitive meltdown here. Anyway, then she just goes like, "Well, I can't create life. What does that say about me?" Okay, we're just going to throw that out there. Like, infertility is like quite a hot button, You know, anything can be a hot button to the right person, but infertility, it's one of those things that's very much under the radar. You know, you hear a lot of hot buttons about LGBT issues, for example, or race. But in many parts of the world, including, you know, the Western world, childbirth is seen as a huge thing. Culturally, many people still don't really consider a marriage a proper marriage until there's a child involved. And to be infertile in this culture is actually to be subjected to quite a bit of stigma. So just throwing that out there, you're pushing the boundaries a bit. And the thing is, it doesn't amount to anything. We'll get back to it in a minute, but basically I think it's probably just there for some sort of symbolism that went right over my head, like the virgin miracle birth or something. Anyway, they decide to go at it like rabbits in celebration. And the guy wakes up in the morning and he's like, oh, fuck, I feel like shit. Now, I'm guessing that he's just assuming that he's hungover, because, you know, if you've been exposed to, like, an alien world, and you've confirmed that there is alien life, if you're feeling ill, it might be wise to report it. You know, I'm just throwing that out there, you know, you don't know what's in the air, especially because you were stupid enough to take your helmet off, and oh dear, you're now infected with something. Okay, the infection didn't come from the air, but as even the characters then later on go, we don't know how he was infected by this stuff. Any of us could have been exposed. Yeah, because you took your fucking helmets off, you doofuses. Anyway, he's looking in the mirror, and he's like this in the mirror, like pulling down his eyeball. Oh, God. And then this little black oil worm, and again, X-Files black oil moment pops out, and he's like, ugh. Now, I'm willing to write off that he may have thought that was just like a trick of the light or like a hallucination or something, because it's not like a huge black bleh. It's just like this little thing that pops out and wriggles. But if he's so ill that he's hallucinating, even if he's just hungover, he probably shouldn't be going on the mission. You know, he's endangering himself and everyone around him. And that's, I just can't explain how stupid this character actually is. Anyway, they go back in, and because of the fact that Shaw's partner's like now getting really fucking sick, we're talking like walking dead sick here, they need to go back to the ship. As they're on their way back, they do find the two chuckle fucks, and it's like one of them's like completely fucked, totally dead. That's the guy who was getting high. Then the other guy, it's like they look at him and the mask is broken, and there's something living in his stomach, in his mouth, and it pops out, and it's one of the snake serpent things, and then it just wriggles off and nothing more comes of it. So they are all basically running now. And when they get back, they're saying, oh yeah, this guy's really ill, I think he was called Holloway, I can't remember, it didn't matter. He's like, he's really sick, you need to prep a medical pod so we can freeze him. And Meredith is waiting for them with a fucking flamethrower, and they get back, and then she's like, there is no fucking way I'm letting him on board. In like probably one of the first intelligent moves we've seen from people in this film, she's just there with the flamethrower, and they're like, no, you can't do this. You have no fucking idea how infectious this is. Unless you can get this guy into the pod without him taking his suit off, and even then, you've got to be 100% certain that suit is sealed. I mean, let's face it, he was fine less than 24 hours ago, and now he's at death's door. Whatever this is, it's going through a human immune system like a Viking through a nunnery. The idea of keeping that off the ship, smart move. So anyway, he says, do it, and she roasts him, and Shaw is beaten to the ground as she's doing the whole no thing, and which is okay, fair enough, because you know her boyfriend is dead, whatever, okay, fine, that's perfectly human response, not wanting him to die, perfectly normal, that whole scene, not a big problem with it. You have a character who is acting reasonable in the situation, characters who are acting unreasonable, but they're acting unreasonable because there's an emotional content there, and emotion has a tendency to override reason, and that's fine. But that doesn't mean that all the stupid shit they did before is excused because they had absolutely no reason to not do it. So anyway, she wakes up having just, before she went down, she was like, oh, we need full quarantine procedures or whatever. And she wakes up and David's scanning her and says, this is highly impertinent, but I have to ask you, have you been fucked recently? And she says, yes, last night. And they discover that she's basically 3 months pregnant. And this is the reason why the infertility thing came in earlier, to make sure that there was absolutely no connotations that this pregnancy couldn't be considered not miraculous. Alright, there was no way you couldn't consider this pregnancy miraculous. So, let's think about this for a moment. 3 months pregnant. I'm pretty sure a woman would know if she was 3 months pregnant. You know, there's a little thing that women go through each month that doesn't happen if they're pregnant. Yeah. Not to mention the fact that I would find it very difficult to believe that she didn't have some sort of physical before they sent them off on this trip that would have picked up the pregnancy, especially if it was 3 months in. So we didn't need this infertility thing thrown in to make sure that we are aware that this is not possible. And I think this is an example of, I don't think Ridley Scott is insulting our intelligence, but I think he's assuming that the audience is a lot more stupid than they actually are. We can draw conclusions, and this, combined with the fact that he doesn't really challenge our conceptions, or doesn't really make us raise anything more than skin-deep questions on this issue, and even then there aren't many of those, really does show a disdain for the audience, if you like. David then goes, this is not a traditional fetus. Those are the words he uses, this is not a traditional fetus. And she just goes, I want it out of me. But by this point, we've cottoned on that, you know, David's got his own agenda, and he's basically working for the interests of the corporation, not the crew. So he says, no, we're going to stick you in a medical pod. You're not going to get a C-section or anything like that. We're just going to stick you in a medical pod. And he gives her a drug to knock her out. When she wakes up, there are two doctors preparing to move her. They're, like, pinching her and slapping her and trying to wake her up. And they just assume she's doped out of her skull, even though she's actually awake. And the moment they, like, put hands on her, she beats one of them around the head with this thing, you don't see what it is, and then, like, kicks the other one, fights them down. And then as she's getting off the bed, this thing that she hit them with, she puts her hand on it and it compresses. So I don't know if that's, like, a different prop and I've just read that scene wrong, or if it was actually a genuine blooper, because something that compresses that easily and is that flexible, I don't think you're going to be able to do a lot of damage. You do more damage with a rolled-up newspaper, to be honest. So, what does she do? She makes a beeline for the surgery suite in Meredith's lifeboat. Smart move. When they get there, well, when she gets there, she tells her, I need a C-section. And it says, I'm sorry, this unit is configured for male patients only. I'm sorry, this unit is configured for male patients only. Now, let's consider this. Aside from the fact that, you know, why would you create something like that? I mean, I can appreciate that maybe you would require, like, a different operating procedure for female anatomy to male anatomy, perhaps. But even still, why would you not program those routines in? You know, you're kind of limiting your market by about 50%. If you're completely excluding women. And again, I think the inference is that it can't perform female specific operations, but it can perform operations on both sexes. But I think I think that's what they were getting at, but it's really badly explained, because the words are, this thing is configured for male patients only. But even putting that aside, why does the captain, who wants to be prepared for all eventualities to the point where she has her own floating lifeboat with 2 fucking years' worth of supplies on board, have something geared up for male-only patients? Remember what I said earlier about it maybe being geared for both sexes but not able to perform female-only ones? That is supposition. That's me trying to make sense of what the movie is putting out there. What it's telling me is women can't use this thing. Why? Why would she have it? Did she order the wrong one off eBay? Did she not check the instruction manual? I find it very difficult to believe that in this survival pod, she's going to have something that she can't use. Anyway, it's pointless because she jumps in the thing and just says, foreign objects in abdomen, please remove, and the thing performs a C-section. She's jabbing painkillers in left, right, and centre, and the thing just gets a laser and whips her open, and then it's just like a crane game thing pops down and pulls out this, it looks halfway between a squid and a sperm. It's remarkably unpleasant. The scene is a very unpleasant scene. And I don't think appropriately unpleasant either. I mean, gore has its place and things, but I'm not sure what they were trying to achieve. I think it may have been... Obviously, the legend of Prometheus, the Titan, he was punished for giving fire to humans by being chained to a rock, and a bird would come and peck his liver out each day. Is there supposed to be some sort of parallel there? Because I don't see it. It's like, oh well, Prometheus was like cut open every day, and she's being cut up open. Yeah, but she's not being cut open every day, and they're not pulling out a liver. They're pulling out this other thing. And you know, I get the illusion, but I don't see the point of it. And I think that is my big problem with this movie, is it references stuff. It references questions, it references ideas, and it references existing notions, and then it completely ignores them. It doesn't bother to incorporate them into the actual thing to present us with new ways of looking at things. It doesn't present us with new takes on what we know. It doesn't give us anything that we don't already know. It just goes, this, this, wow. And for my money, that's not intellectually stimulating. That's just it's just pointing at something interesting and going, look at that, and then not bothering to actually explain anything about it. Like if you were on holiday and a tour guide said, look at that building there, and it was like this really odd building, you'd be like, huh. And then if the tour guide just moved on, you'd be a bit pissed. You'd be like, well, what is it? Why does it look different? What does it do? What's the history behind it? And that's the best analogy I can think of to describe the delivery of the ideas in Prometheus. So anyway, the thing's whipped out, and suddenly there's a decontamination procedure inside the thing, and it kills the alien after Shaw's got out of it. She actually has to rip the abdominal cord out herself, literally rip it out of the C-section incision, and she's then stapled up. She's had major abdominal surgery, and she has more drugs in her system than Charlie Sheen. And she's still able to run around. Oh, occasionally the director makes her go, oh, clutch her stomach. But after surgery that invasive, because it's not like a little keyhole thing, they whip her open from hip to hip and pull the thing out. Going back to Red Dwarf. And on drugs on top of that, and yet she's fine. She can run around. Well, she's not fine, but she's mobile. She can run around the ship. So as she's running to escape, she comes across Wayland, who was on the ship all along. Oh. So just moving through my notes here. I'm on the last page now, so we're nearly at an end. Okay. So she encounters Wayland, and the first thing that you see is that this guy has been aged with makeup, the actor has been aged with makeup, and it looks fucking ridiculous. Aging makeup, I think, always looks really bad, especially when you're trying to create a really, really old-looking character. It just doesn't work. It has never looked realistic. It looks rubbery. It looks fake. And this is no exception. It just looks stupid. The shit kicker is, we never see a young Wayland in the film, so why didn't they just hire, like, a really old actor? And then, I admit, I think it has something to do with the viral marketing, but honestly, if the marketing looking good is more important to you than the movie looking good, that's a fucked up set of priorities. And again, that shows a real disdain for the audience. All we want is to get you in the theatre and get your money. What you actually experience, not my problem. Even better, why not have a young Wayland, and the reason for him dying not being old age but some sort of genetic disorder, and there's plenty that you could choose from, and that would add, I think, a more emotive element to the film. It wouldn't just be the case of meeting the creator and asking them, why did you make me to die? Why did you make us to die? And why did you make me to die before everyone else? That, I think, could have added a lot more to it, but it's not the way they chose to go, and the way they chose to go, I think, it just detracts from it. Here's an example. Because he's so old, he can't get around on his own, so he's got this sort of, like, powered exoskeleton. It's not like the big forklifting thing. It's just, like, clamps. It's like a sort of, like, polio brace, basically, but for his whole body. The problem is, between that and the makeup, the character looks ridiculous. Now, any sort of poignance you're trying to put across in scenes with this setup is instantly null and void when the audience starts laughing at the character. So you got the ridiculous looking rubber makeup face, and then because of the way that this exoskeleton thing works, he's kind of doing this zombie sideways crab shuffle. People in the cinema were laughing, and I was laughing at them, and this is supposed to be like possibly some sort of symbol of the human condition, or the whole epitome of the angst of not knowing why certain things are as they are, and people are laughing at it. So yeah, the delivery there, no, didn't work. There's also another really weird scene. This film has loads of these pointless little moments. Like, remember earlier on I was saying about one of the two guys who got trapped in the pyramid was getting high? It never adds anything to the plot. I don't get why it's there. I don't know if it's like some sort of symbolism, but again, it's just making the character look really, really stupid at the expense of possibly some sort of highbrow idea. And this is another one. It's revealed that Vickers is in fact Wayland's daughter. And the potential there is huge. If you're going to be talking about the idea of where we came from and those sorts of ideas, the creation of life and responsibility, the parent-child relationship is a huge part of that. Especially because there is almost a creator that you can ask, why did you choose to have kids? Why did you choose to have me? The parallels that you could draw there are really good, and they don't do anything with it. It's not revealed until right up until the end of the film, and then it's just this one scene where she's in front of him. At first I thought it was like I got like a sexual vibe from it. She was like sniffing his hand, and it's like, what the fuck am I going on here? But yeah, that was something. Again, there's probably some sort of symbolism in there that's going way over my head, but at the end of the day, you could have used that parallel, and then they decided not to go with it, instead throwing in some sort of twist that never went anywhere. Okay, so David's actually discovered that there is one of these engineers left alive, or the space jockeys, as people like to call them, and he's in a hypersleep chamber. So they all go there. They wake the thing up, and the control panel on the ship is like another one of those what the fuck moments. It's controlled by a flute. You have to use a flute to bring up this control panel, and then it's sort of like a holographic Minority Report style touch display, but it makes no sense. But whatever, it's alien, alright? It's alien, I'm prepared to buy that. I don't quite get the flute thing, but I can buy that I'm not supposed to understand the display. That's fine. David wakes the thing up, and it gets out of the cryostasis. It's like a huge thing, like a giant. It's basically, for those of you who've seen Alien, it's built roughly the same proportions as they're seen in Alien, but maybe slightly smaller, but not by much. So it gets out, takes the helmet off. David tries to talk to it, and the immediate response is, it's up, you know, it's looking around, it's like, David tries to talk to it, and then it just looks at him and it rips his head off. Literally grabs him, twists, hauls, chucks. Then proceeds to basically beat the crap out of everyone, and Shaw, who's come with him, is the only person who gets out of there and just basically runs like hell. So what did he say? Did it recognize humans? Well, this is explained in a scene which occurs at some point in the timeline before this. I can't remember where. There's another scene, the zombie. I'll come back to that one. And these are two scenes that I can't remember where in the chronology of the film they occur. These were points in the film where I was just basically just going, trying to catch up with all the stupid that had been poured onto me from that point forwards. But the captain says that the facility that they're on is an outpost because they weren't stupid enough to develop weapons of mass destruction on their own world, and they were going to use it to wipe out all life on Earth, and then suddenly something happened and it got out and they never managed to do the mission. And this all happened about 2,000 years ago. Anyway, This like, how does he know this? This is like pure conjecture, and he's selling it as if it's fact. So I don't quite know where he's got this from. I mean, it also kind of goes against it because we see one of these guys, like I say, drinking this black oil stuff in the opening credits. And was this like a contaminated batch? I mean, I reckon it could have easily just been some sort of toxic waste dump for like a batch of their magical life-seeding fluid that went wrong. Makes sense to me. Dump it on a planet as far away as possible. I don't know where he's come up with this. And David again references it when they're going on to meet the space jockey. And he says something like... Again, this is one of those lines where it sounds really clever until you think about it. And Shaw asks him, why were they going to kill us? And... he says, sometimes you have to destroy to create. Well, okay, yeah. But if they created humans, why are they then going to kill humans? Are we going to be, like, replaced by something else? What? It asks the... obviously it raises the question, why do they want to destroy us? Which is the question that we leave the movie with. But... this is just a question that the movie raises about its own internal universe. It doesn't give the audience anything to go away with to think about in our own lives and reality. And for my money, science fiction needs to do that. I mean, not all science fiction. Stuff like, for example, Star Wars and J.J. Abrams' Star Trek movie, they're action movies. They're science fantasy, if you will. It's not about... hard science. It's not supposed to be thought-provoking. It's supposed to be an entertaining narrative without much depth to it, and some nice special effects, and so on. But this is supposed to be deeper. This is supposed to be proper science fiction. This is supposed to be raising questions. And if all the only questions it can actually raise are those within its own narrative, that's a bit disappointing. That's a bit of a letdown. So I'm sorry we've had to jump back there, but it's important to put this in context. So, they've twigged that the facility itself is also an engineer ship, and it was this ship that was loaded up and ready to take off and ready to go to Earth. And it's like that it's buried, or it's in like an underground hangar or something like that. So the ship takes off, and the crew of the Prometheus, the ones who are left on board, decide, right, fuck it, we can't let this thing get to Earth. How do they know it's going to Earth? I think maybe there's a sequence earlier where David discovers a hypersleep chamber, and it's like inferred they had a course plotted for Earth. I actually thought it was just some sort of reference to Earth being somewhere where they'd been, or it responding to his, like, the way that he looked. Like, he may be a robot, but maybe it's, like, responding to... I don't know. This is the film that says we've got a 100% DNA match with 8-foot-tall albino monstrosities. Either way, it's getting up, it's going to Earth, so fuck it, we'll just accept it. So they decide to ram it. Okay, fair enough. You're convinced this thing's going to come to Earth. You've seen what this shit can do. You're not going to let it go. So Charlize Theron's character, Vickers, is like, no fucking way, no fucking way. And the captain's like, well, I'm the one who flies the ship. None of you are going to stop me, so I guess we're ramming the fucker. You've got 40 seconds to get to an escape pod. So, despite the fact that they've set up that this captain's quarters are like a lifeboat, she doesn't go there. She goes to a different set of escape pods with, like, no food, no water, literally just a pod which you can get out in. I don't know if maybe I read it wrong. Maybe the captain's quarters aren't a lifeboat because they eject that too, and then it's like established that they can go to it later. But even so, that's like, well, what happens if something happens when you're in space? I mean, surely the whole point of having something like this there is so that you can survive long enough to be retrieved. You know, unless the escape pods actually have like little thrusters on them that you can control, and you can actually pilot it, and then you can actually dock with the captain's quarters. What's the point of it? Either way, again, we're nitpicking a bit here, so move on. We'll just accept this is how it is. So it crashes down onto the planet. The Prometheus rams the ship. Ramming it is super effective. It comes down, and Charlize Theron's character Vickers, after she's got out of the escape pod, is crushed by this thing, and then it also falls on shore. Only it doesn't. She's fine because there was a rock behind her. Yeah, never mind the fact that all the weight of the ship above the rock is gonna crush it down like that. I think there's that strained my suspension of disbelief a lot. But again, we're nitpicking. It's acceptable. We'll move on. Just gonna again put up my notes here. Say going through the entire movie, I can't do it all out of my head. So again, this is a vlog. This isn't supposed to be a professional presentation, as it were. This is me just having a rant about something that really annoyed me. Okay, so Shaw rolls out and heads to the captain's lifeboat and gets on board and starts getting supplies ready. And sure enough, there's a jump scare because the alien that was dead in the surgical thing is now alive and is now huge. Again, the speed and the growth on this thing, because it goes from, like, yay big body with yay big tentacles on it to the size, basically it's the size of a fucking mini, all in the space of a few hours, maybe a day tops. Now, this isn't new. Okay, the alien life cycle has been like established as being somewhat unfounded in biology, shall we say. It's very interesting, and from a science fiction perspective, I quite like it, because, you know, it's just interesting to think about it, and things do grow very, very quickly. But on top of everything else, this is something that I would have let go, or probably not even noticed. But by this point, after all the crap that I'd had, I was so uninvested in the movie that I wasn't willing to just... I probably wouldn't have even noticed if I'd have been in the movie. I'd been like, oh my god, the thing's gone huge. And it wouldn't have gone any further than that. But either way, the thing is now massive. So, David contacts her and tells her, there are other engineer ships. I can fly them and I can take us home. But you're going to have to come and pick me up because I'm feeling a bit detached at the moment. He doesn't actually say that, but he basically just explains, you need to come pick me up, head, body. I'm going to need both in order to be able to pilot these fuckers home. Oh, by the way, he's coming for you. What? David's in the same room as him, so it's like fairly obvious that he's, you know, able to see that the engineer has survived the crash and has now left. The question is, how does he know that he's leaving to get shore? And also, does he know that the ship has been rammed? Maybe the guy's going to, like, you know, fix the power coupling or something. It just makes very little sense as he would know that. Well, he obviously knows Shaw's alive because he can reach her on the communicator, but how does he know he's going after her? How does he know that there aren't other survivors and the guy's going after them? Is he speaking about going after you in general as in the collective group? Perhaps that's it. But either way, it's... Again, it's like one of those, oh, did you read the script moments? So it arrives at the lifeboat. And of course, charges in. So, what does Shaw do again? Something fairly intelligent. She opens the door to the medical bay, and immediately, this huge tentacle beast leaps out and reenacts some hentai on this engineer, while she makes good her escape. And we then get a really shock reveal when the thing finally gives in and falls down, and the facehugger just throat fucks it and lands on top of it and starts to curl around it, and it's revealed it's a giant face hugger. As I say, it's a face hugger the size of a mini. It's a little bit more squiddish than the others. I mean, the others look like sort of like hands that grasp. This looks more like it's got more tentacles rather than legs or fingers. It looks very aquatic, I think, is the best way to describe it. All, in fact, all the aliens in this look very aquatic. Everything's now hunky-dory. The engineer is dead. David is picked up. It's another one of those really stupid lines. He looks at her and says, after all this, you still believe, don't you? And she doesn't say anything. And again, it's just one of those, alright, fine, whatever. Can you give me some context to this? Are we going to have a little bit of character development? Either way, this is something that I don't have much of a frame of reference to, so I'm not going to dwell on it. Then there's the one of the most pretentious lines of the film, where she says, "No, we're not going to Earth," and that makes plenty of sense. They've decided they can't go back in an earlier scene because what happens if they bring this infection with them? They don't know how they got infected. Because and any of them could be infected because they were wandering around outside without their fucking helmets on. So any of them could be infected, so they decide they're not going back. So she says, I'm going to their homeworld. And it's inferred that she still wants to know why it was that they wanted to kill them these 2,000 years ago. Could there be a connotation here? Perhaps we nailed one of them to something. I don't know. Pretty sure there would actually be texts at that time period referencing giant fucking albino bastards. Oh, and don't give me some sort of like bollocks as to like holographic shift change or something like that. Just don't, please don't. It's stupid. Either way, and David says, well, surely the answer is completely irrelevant now. I mean, they want to kill you, you've stopped them, you know, they're probably not going to tell you. A lot of things are inferred, and she just basically says, well, you wouldn't understand because you're a robot. Oh, for fuck's sake. Again, I can see the purpose of the line. It's sort of the creator looking down on their creation as being unworthy. But again, from a narrative perspective, it just makes the character sound really pretentious. So the line does serve some purpose,
but it serves that purpose at the expense of the narrative. And I think that really is the problem with Prometheus, is there has been so much emphasis on the gorgeous visuals, so much emphasis on the symbolism, and the narrative was just considered secondary to that. And like I said, maybe you dig that in films. If you dig symbolism and visuals in films, you'll have a blast with Prometheus. It's made for people like you. Me personally, I'm in it for the story, I'm in it for the characters, and I'm in it for the questions and the new ideas, new ways of looking at things that it can raise. And that is thin on the ground. Oh yeah, the other scene, the zombie scene. So it's like when they encounter the two guys who are trapped inside the barrow, one of them, the guy who actually got the thing down his throat, they look at him and he's like, what's going on here? What's going on here? And then it leaps out at them. At that point, that combined with the fact that Shaw's partner Holloway is like really sick, prompts them to basically GTFO. But they leave the other guy there, the guy who was getting stoned off his, out of his mind. He comes back. So he's covered in the black oil, and I half phased out for this scene, so I may not be like retelling it correctly. The captain, I think, spots that there's something outside the ship, so they open the hangar or lower the elevator, whatever it is they do to get outside the ship. And one of the security guys sees the spacesuit there crumpled up. So, you know that this can't be good. So again, in another example of prime stupidity, what does he do? Does he goes up to it and he tows it. Yeah, that's clever. I mean, okay, it's not quite as stupid as some of the stuff we've seen, but given the fact that all crew members who are known to be alive are present and accounted for, and, you know, you didn't leave any empty spacesuits behind on the surface anywhere. Not wise, dude. Like, radio in and say, Captain? Yeah, it kind of looks like someone. Everyone's accounted for, right? Can we do, like, a sound-off? Okay. Shit, this is weird. Somebody get me a really long stick. But no, he goes up to it, he tows it, and lo and behold, it's the guy from earlier who's now a spider zombie. He's like super strong, super fast, and he's leaping around all over the place. And it's basically an action scene, and eventually they beat him by running him over with an ATV twice and then setting him on fire with a flamethrower. So again, that scene, I think, is again one that could have been handled a lot better. If I'd have been writing that scene, I would have used it as a tease. People are expecting the alien. Have it as the captain's picked up like movement outside of the ship, like things on the cameras, or, you know, just like motion sensors, whatever. Just some sort of security system has picked something up outside the ship. They send a team to investigate. And basically, you could just have, rather than having an elongated action scene, you just have a couple of minutes where the team's wandering around the ship. Tense music, tense shots moving past the team, and then in the background, out of focus movement, or at the edge of the shot, something just jumping out of the frame. And we've established this thing can jump, and this thing can move, and this thing can climb. So you have this movement in the background, dark coloured movement, dark blur, background, scurrying up the walls. It's a tease. And not only is it a tease, but it also builds up a lot of tension. And that build-up of tension is a lot more scary than the jump frights, which is all this movie goes in for. Now again, I'm not saying it's a horror movie. It's not. But if you want to actually, if you're trying to scare your audience, fucking try and scare them. Jump scares don't work because we can see them coming a mile off in this case. But if you build up tension like that, that's a lot more scary, and also it's a tease. So, then there's the final message left by Shaw as she leaves, which is some overly florid crap. Something like, I am the last survivor. We came here looking for our creators. There is only death here now. Oh, God. I've got a good one for you. How about, I am Elizabeth Shaw. I am the last survivor of the Prometheus. We came here looking for our creators. Unfortunately, they were killed by some sort of bioweapon which we released. This planet is now extremely dangerous. We don't know how this thing contaminates people. We don't know how it works. All we know is it's really, really dangerous and deadly. There is nothing left for you here anymore. All of the creators, all of the engineers are dead or gone. There may be some technology lying around, but there is this fucking bioweapon here. Please find attached mission files as I was able to recover them. Of course, you know, that's not as florid, so meh. Again, nitpick, but it was another little thing. Even if you take out all of the big things that are wrong with this movie, all the plot holes that I outlined, you still end up with so many things that are wrong with it that you can't ignore them. Like I said, I can ignore little inconsistencies, but when they keep piling up, you can't ignore them. It's just not possible. It's like you can ignore a fly buzzing around the room. You can't ignore 12 of the bastards. Okay, so where does that leave us ultimately? What's the conclusion that we draw from all this? Well, Prometheus is not a terrible movie. It's quite well acted. Actress who plays Elizabeth Shaw, I can't remember her name now. It's completely gone. I'm considering a couple of things. Numi. Oh, I can't remember the surname. Either way, she delivers quite a good performance. Fassbender as David, brilliant. I love that character. I love that performance. That was great. It was one of the few things that actually kept me in my seat for the movie. I wanted to see what he was going to do next. I wanted to see how he was going to do it. That character was great. It was the only reason I didn't walk out. The cinematography is achingly beautiful at times. It's very well shot. It's very well framed. There's a lot of detail. It's very, very much Ridley Scott in that regard. But ultimately, the narrative is atrocious. It falls flat on its face. Ideas and concepts that the audience should be thinking about are alluded to, but never really expanded on. They're referenced, but never given any substance. And for my money, that's not enough. Like I say, I'm not expecting answers. Giving answers to questions like this would just be pretentious. But you at least need to get us thinking. The only questions this film asks are questions within its own narrative. It takes huge, huge liberties with science, to the point where, basically, if we acknowledge science as it stands, there is no plot here. You can argue that's the case with a lot of science fiction. It's like, whoa, we don't have warp drives, we don't have teleporters. But at the end of the day, Star Trek at least attempts to ground itself in science insofar as they're referencing current things within the field. Like there's one part of the transporter in Star Trek, I forget the name of it, the something corrector, but it refers to the theory that if you're going to be teleporting molecules, you can't just teleport them in their relative position to each other, but you also need to transfer over their movement as well. And there's a part of the transporter that corrects that. And that's, again, one thing that I quite like in Star Trek. It makes an effort to establish itself as scientifically credible, even if it isn't. It helps to create the illusion. Here, there's no attempt at illusion. There's nothing there to help you suspend your disbelief on. The science that's present is extremely dodgy, and that detracts, I think, a lot from the idea. But the whole premise is, frankly, absurd. I have no problem with the idea that life started somewhere else and was carried to Earth and then evolved here. That's fine. I don't see any problems with that theory. I'm not a particular adherent to it, but I'm not going to say that it's stupid. But the idea that humanity specifically was engineered goes against so much science we have, and the movie even says that it does, and then it never addresses this point. It never addresses this fact. It just says, oh, so you're going to throw 3 centuries of Darwinism out the window. And then that's it. It never brings up this issue again. You've got to you could at least try and incorporate it. Even if you're going to give me bullshit, don't insult my intelligence. At least try and lie to me. So, I didn't have a good time. But if you're heavily into symbolism and you just like looking at pretty images, and you know there are a lot of people who dig that from cinema, you'll like it. Anyone else, it's not going to be for you. So I'm going to leave this there because this has run on for far too long already. Take care, everyone, and see you all soon.